I'm Kyle Chayka, and I'm a writer.
From David Zwirner, this is Dialogues, a podcast about artists and the way they think.
What is good minimalism? Like, I think it's seeing your own sights and feeling your own perceptions.
Hi, I'm Lucas Zwirner, and this week's episode is a little new for us. As we grow and evolve Dialogues during this time, we'll be releasing some episodes that don't always feature an interesting pairing, but focus instead on a single interesting and relevant topic or person. For this episode, I spoke to Kyle Chayka, an art critic and journalist who recently published The Longing for Less, a book that has been discussed a lot in the art world and outside of it. It attempts to diagnose why the minimalist aesthetic is so appealing right now, from Marie Kondo fanatics to the capital M minimalist artists so many people love. It feels like the timing of Kyle's book was no accident, and it was especially resonant for me, with the opening of the major Donald Judd retrospective at MoMA last month. While you can't visit that show right now, hopefully this episode explores some of the important questions it poses for culture at large.
Do you have one that you
carry around?
You've got one marked up. But it's not that annotated, actually.
No, well, this one is clean. It's just like the two sections that I often read.
Okay, got it. What are the two sections that you often read?
The first one is just from the introduction, and it's kind of like why millennials are minimalist and kind of what are the larger forces that have made minimalism more popular. And then the other was like the sensory deprivation tank anecdote, because it's like funny and relatable.
Without rehashing your introduction, what brought you to the point where you thought this was the moment to write the minimalism book? I think the real strength of this book is that it is bridging the gap between what we might call mainstream minimalism and the aesthetic and philosophical traditions that underpin what has become mainstream minimalism.
Totally. So it was kind of in response to seeing that commercialized version of minimalism, the form that's become really popular. And so I think somewhere around 2015, 2016, I started noticing how like minimalism was applied to so many different things that kind of had nothing to do with art or design or anything. So you could have a minimalist skincare routine, or you could have a minimalist restaurant, or you could have whatever, anything could be minimalist. And so my own background in art history, like my reference frame for minimalism was that original art movement and was the specific people in the 60s. And so I was just curious how that happened, like how this very niche concept and a kind of radical art movement became an incredibly popular mainstream lifestyle word. And can you connect the two? Like, do they have some connection, or is this just a kind of weird coincidence that happened?
And of course, one pivot point in that conversation is the sort of Marie Kondo figure who takes it from sort of somewhat mainstream with the books to kind of mainstream with the TV show and
the Netflix show,
and it continues now. But do you think the seeds of it were really germinating, so to speak, in mainstream culture before that ignition point?
Yeah. I mean, you can talk about the whole arc of minimalism from the 60s when it was established as a word and as an art movement through fashion and design and architecture in the 70s, 80s, 90s. But then I think the kind of formative moment for minimalism recently was right around the financial crisis and like 2008 through 2010. So in that moment, there was this big turn toward living simply and like reconsidering your consumerism and what you could buy or needed to buy, and this like revising of lifestyle aspirations into something maybe less grand. So I think at that moment, there were a bunch of American lifestyle bloggers who started calling themselves minimalist, and they kind of coined it as a lifestyle word and as a label for managing your consumption, like buying less stuff, figuring out what you own. That is kind of where minimalism jumped from something that was purely aesthetic or like is a kind of artistic concept into something that could be applied to anything else.
And could, I mean, become a marketing word in some ways.
Yeah, exactly. Like it becomes a brand.
Brand,
at that moment, yeah.
And I think part of what you do explicitly in the book is talk about the fact that the original aspirations of some of these artists, whether it's Agnes Martin or Donald Judd, are very, very different from the movement as it has been applied in its mass, its sort of mass world, mass application.
Right. So Marie Kondo is not talking about the same things as Agnes Martin, but the weird thing is that this word minimalism gets applied to both of them.
In your thinking about it, what is the key difference between what someone like Agnes Martin, in all her kind of radicality, what does she really mean, or what would we mean when we talk about her? And what is meant by the mainstream folks? I don't want to throw Marie Kondo under the bus too much, but you know, let's just call it the mainstream minimalists, as it were, you know?
Right. Like, I mean, the mainstream minimalists to me are always about consumption, buying less or more stuff. Like, you're never changing your relationship to the objects or the world around you. You're just kind of more carefully picking what objects you're consuming, or like obsessing even more on just a few objects that you own. Agnes Martin was someone who decided to live in completely her own way and kind of broke with every social expectation that was put on her and defined herself as an artist almost like in isolation and on her own, and came up with this kind of deeply radical vision that was about universality and like this kind of overwhelming spirit of the world and humanity. And that's like not about objects. It's not about an aesthetic even. It's about trying to like reach this transcendental state. And I don't think like cleaning your apartment is about trying to reach transcendence, but you know, maybe for some people it could be.
What are the steps that bring a sort of program like that mm-hmm. to a place where it is being marketed and kind of sold at large?
It was almost a series of steps away from that original idea. And like, they're all logical steps, but in the end you get very far from this like initial moment in the 50s, 60s. So when you start with like Agnes Martin, Judd, or like John Cage, like the minimalist composer, you talk about these ideas that are like deeply radical, a kind of re-envisioning of the world around you, a non-judgmental state of mind that's about like changing your aesthetic expectations and like seeing the world directly is how I always thought about it. And at that moment, I think the way that minimalism kind of started to go off from the art track was through art galleries, weirdly. Like, I think the white cube aesthetic that emerged to contextualize minimalist objects was part of what people took minimalism as. Like, they confused the space that the object was in with the object itself. And so that like white walled aesthetic, I think, became more and more popular until today. We see it kind of in a luxury fashion boutique, in a new condo, in, you know, a hotel. That's kind of become the dominant like luxury signifier of our time.
Meaning that in a funny way, the ultimate luxury signifier of our time is the ability to sort of have a very expensive shell, as it were, as opposed to lots of, let's say, well-curated or you know, objects to fill a space. It's much more about the container as such, potentially.
Yeah, like it's about the space itself, which I think can be interesting. Like, I think there's a point to having a nice space and a nice backdrop, but if you're not filling it with anything, like that's becomes really bizarre to me and kind of a misunderstanding of what that choice and that aesthetic meant originally.
In the critiques of minimalism, the art movement that kind of came to the fore even during its lifetime. In particular, one which you bring up early on in your book, which is Michael Fried's critique of Donald Judd and the literalists or minimalists, as they were variously referred to. And the key term in that critique, or the key two terms, are, you know, this idea of absorption or presentness and theatricality or self-reflectivity. Mm-hmm. That of course, that self-reflectivity has become determines all of people's interactions with lowercase minimalism, right? Mm-hmm. That in a way, that kind of theater of the self encountering the art is the dominant mode of art perception and experience today.
Right, like it becomes narcissistic, I think. It encourages you to like bounce the experience back on yourself and kind of obsess over your own perception, which like was a little bit of the point. Like, you do want to think about how you're perceiving something, but you don't want to just think about yourself. Like, you don't want to just have it be the theatrical experience. You want to have, there's a kind of formal aesthetic experience that needed to happen. And that's what it was trying to prompt, I think.
And I think that's, in a funny way, that's the danger with that particular critique of minimalism, is that it sort of ignores, it's so interested in the experience of the object that it ignores the formal innovations of the objects themselves.
And so, I mean, I really do like the Wilhelm, what is Wilhelm?
Yeah,
is
Richard Wilhelm.
Richard Wilhelm's great, like 64 essay that coined the term minimalism, minimal art. I really liked its description of how minimalist art is confusing because it removes the things that we expect from a work of art. It removes the like individual expression, the energetic brushstrokes, the like the idea that you express emotion and instead reduces that down to like these bare essential facts of an object. And yet he says like the reason that it is good artwork and is successful is because those choices of material, of form, of like repetition are still valid artistic choices and should be appreciated as like intentional acts of art making.
And sort of isolates, I think, a different kind of decision making. It's not the decision of how to express yourself. It's actually a decision of, interestingly, it is a decision about the framing mechanisms or the kind of material decisions that precede any other expressive decisions, right? It's almost like zooming back a little bit from the art making process. So you're no longer analyzing what decisions were made on the canvas, but analyzing the decision to have a canvas in the first place.
Right. As if you're like just designing the canvas or like just designing the encounter with the art object without the content that you then expect to read from it. Like I like Judd's talking about how you read or don't read an object and if you get a narrative from an object. And like, actually, I find minimalist art really refreshing, and then it doesn't have a narrative, and you don't need to like read the story into it or read the expression.
I always thought that a serious art form emerges when a number of people commit a lot of time to thinking about it, something. And it is clear that whatever Judd was thinking about, he was thinking about with real intensity, whether it was the quality of the bolts that connect something, the texture of the color that's being put on the surface of an object, the surface itself, the material decisions. And of course, you can say those are less important than the decisions that go into the sort of intentionality that goes into making a painting or expressing yourself in a painting. But that's not clear to me, you know?
And this was the innovation of those artists, is that you did not have, you could think about those decisions rather than thinking about the, you know, the abex brushstroke or the content of the painting.
Right. So coming back to the kind of unfolding of the book, you kind of noticed that the movement was beginning to happen on some level, right? And then did you begin to arrange your life such that you could be collecting data, as it were, for a book like this?
Yeah. I mean, I'm, you know, throughout my career, I've been a freelance journalist and like writing magazine features and things like that. So it's kind of like I actually started out as an art critic and an art reporter. And so I would always be following the art world and engaging with it, but also over time, like just thinking about culture at large and always like keeping an eye out for what's going on and like what hits my art sensors or like aesthetic sensors. So through the rest of my writing, I was like paying attention to this stuff. And I began writing this essay for the Times Magazine about the word minimalism and how I was kind of confused as to why it was everywhere right now. And I think luckily for me, minimalism kept being very relevant and kept being like a force in the world. And then, as you mentioned, with the 2018 January 1st Netflix drop of the Marie Kondo reality TV show, I was excited because it meant that a lot of people were still like obsessing over these ideas and Instagramming their drawers or whatever.
I mean, what's interesting is that she is now, of course, selling things. There's a, there's a kind of that it clearly is around consumption, and it clearly is a kind of, it almost feels like the power of the idea in its original form was sensed by kind of like capitalism.
Exactly.
And and then someone stepped in to instrumentalize it for capitalism.
Yeah. I mean, the process really freaks me out, because like capitalism can just fully digest something that started out as a radical anti-consumerist, like almost anti-Western culture thing, could be just turned into the biggest marketing gimmick over the past few years is really kind of staggering.
I think that is the overt kind of, not even the subtext, but the overtext of this book. And I think what's so shocking about the story that you tell, especially by ending with the kind of, frankly, the Eastern philosophical tradition with its focus on Zen and that great term at the end. It's like aware.
Mono no aware.
Mono no aware, exactly.
The beauty of things passing.
The kind of ephemerality of things passing. But the idea that that capitalism's power to identify ideas that will have traction and then monetize them in some way, right?
It's truly incredible. And like, I think also the rise of social media intensified this quite a bit, because minimalism is really well adapted to the internet, and it's a thing that you can signal with what's around you, like using an iPhone.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I guess the immediate question that comes to mind is why not sort of like maximalism, right? I mean, why, in a funny way, it does feel like it's tied to the fact that people want a paring down of ideas right now, or a simplification because of the glut of surplus of information.
Right. I think there's partly it's the overwhelming volume of sensory information that we are forced to process now with the internet, with like hyper-globalization, with technology. We just like encounter and digest more culture and images and information than we ever have before. But then I also think it is about this, like the kind of cyclical nature of minimalism, and the idea of simplification becomes really appealing when society or like civilization feels confusing and out of control. Like minimalism encourages you to just focus on what's there in front of you.
That's interesting. So when you say cyclical nature of it, what are you referring? I mean, do you mean like its first iteration, would you say in the 60s being a response to global confusion, or?
I talk in the book about like capital M minimalism versus lowercase, and the way that we've talked about mainstream minimalism or consumer minimalism versus the formal art movement.
Yeah.
So I think to me, like the lowercase M minimalism, the idea of living simply and kind of like throwing things out is cyclical, and it reoccurs in different historical moments. So in the 60s, we could connect it to like the aftermath of the hippie 60s and the kind of failed social revolution at that point, and the Vietnam War, and just the sense that, well, we tried to change things, we can't change things, let's kind of erase the slate and start over. I think there is an inkling of that, and it certainly exists in the financial crisis aftermath and that desire for minimalism. But I think you can even, and I through the book I talk about this moment in the 1930s when this philosopher called for voluntary simplicity, and he was worried about Ford motor cars and like typewriters or something, whereas now we're worried about iPhones and the internet. And then another philosopher picked up that in the 70s and kind of revived it for another generation. I don't think it's quite snake oil, but you can see how this desire to like start over repeats, but you can never totally start over.
I mean, I guess what's interesting is that I would imagine that those philosophical movements had far less reach than something like the capitalist infused minimalism of someone like me. I'm just talking about the number of people affected simply because that snake oil is not intended to sell an object in the end or sell a worldview.
I mean, it's so much about objects now. I think in the past it was a little less about the specific objects to use a Judd term.
Yeah.
But now the fact that you literally can buy a minimalist lamp, a minimalist coffee table, a minimalist book, it's like it shows just how object obsessed that this idea is.
So when you look at, Judd has a retrospective now up at MoMA, when you look at that, what do you, what do you see in those objects now? Like, what are they, how do they speak to you now through the lens of this minimalist practice that you've traced?
To me, the like beauty of minimalism when it's seen, like the beauty of encountering minimalism is like encountering a bunch of choices that someone made in the past and like this kind of holistic way of living. And so to me, it's really interesting to see, it was like my favorite experiences of minimalism were going to Judd's like homes and studio spaces and the places that he made and seeing how the work was installed there and how the work kind of coexisted with daily life in such a beautiful way. Like, I think that's what appeals to me so much about minimalism and just about art generally is this like integration with the rest of the world. It's kind of inseparable. And so actually seeing the objects in a gallery space is like not totally ideal to me. I like seeing them in a home or in, you know, a permanent installation or something. So it's funny, like you can kind of see how people were confused by them. I mean, it's great to see them all collected together at MoMA, and it's great to see people like encountering them like that. But I kind of, I almost hope it's more of a starting point than an end point, like to look farther into minimalism and like think about the ideas more and like bring it out into the world instead of keeping it in the gallery. Like maybe that was one of the problems or what drove minimalism on this path was like the fact that it was so contained in gallery spaces and so like fetishized almost. And I don't necessarily like the fetishization of it.
Right. It, when you talk about it now, it sort of makes me think that one of the core, you could call one of the core principles of the minimalist aesthetic as it's practiced by artists as a kind of deliberateness, right? Sort of like deliberate way of being, deliberate way of designing objects, a deliberate way of living. And does that sound like a fair,
Totally. I think contextual, intentional, deliberate. I mean, deliberate is very nice because it's like forceful. It's like, we've made a decision to do it this way for a reason.
And I feel that if those objects signal anything, Judd's objects, they do signal deliberateness, right? And in a funny way, I think if whenever you encounter a great art object, it typically signals some kind of deliberateness. Mm. But there happens to be something about this movement and its application to life through, I think, Judd, as somebody who designed furniture that he could live with, yeah. and that made it feel like that deliberateness could be carried into everyday existence in a kind of both first maybe a more difficult way and then an increasingly simplified way.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's it's both the power and maybe the flaw of how that has been and like accepted after, like, as he was working and after his death. Like, it's pretty amazing and unique to me that Judd did turn this like artistic innovation and studio practice into something that truly represented like a holistic way of living. Like, he created the space in which you could do anything in life. You can build a house, you can have a table, you can you can envision what clothes he wanted to wear and like how he wanted to be. And that's, I find that really inspiring.
Yeah, you can also, you can live and think in a minimalist way according to, right? And that's really in that kind of deliberative, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, I'm going to pare out the kind of excesses.
I mean, it's also about an exercise of taste and judgment, I think, in terms of like being conscious of what's around you and understanding and incorporating the things that you've chosen into a holistic philosophy or a holistic way of living. And I think that's like a much more challenging prospect than cleaning your apartment. It's like kind of Marie Kondoing your entire existence and your entire way of thinking. Like, you know, not, I suppose not everyone needs to have this like integrated philosophy to their life, but it's like a way that we can become more aware of what we're doing, not just in aesthetics or interior decorating or whatever, but like in the way that we live.
Would you also talk a little bit about that, the sort of Eastern philosophical underpinnings? In my mind, there are two prongs leading into lowercase m, yeah, or Marie Kondo minimalism. One is the one we've been discussing more of, which is Judd and the 60s. And the other is like a millennium ago.
The idea is kind of filtered down from then, I think. Like, I think, yeah, the roots, two roots of minimalism as we see it today are the artistic innovations and then the specifically Japanese form of Buddhism that kind of went into that country from the year 600 to 1000 or something. And that was kind of how its arc of taking over Japan. And that like flavor of Buddhism and Japan's intentional isolation from China and Korea around like the year 800 or something, it led the way toward this cultivation of a really unique cultural viewpoint and a kind of aestheticized way of living that thrived in the Heian court, which was just the name for the period at the time. And these people, like, you can read about them in The Tale of Genji or The Pillow Book. They live these like hyper-aestheticized, very lazy lives. But they pursued this idea of beauty that was not super dependent on material accumulation and was dependent on this poetic experience of life as it happens around you. And you can think of that value of mono no aware, the like beauty of ephemerality or the beauty of things as they exist in the world, like knowing that the flowers will bloom and die, or like knowing that the snow will melt, and understanding that like we too will pass and we should appreciate what we see while we're here.
In a funny way, I think the idea that both of these prongs of influence, one from the 60s and one from the year 600 to 1000, carry with them a lot of shared characteristics. And chief among them would be this kind of deliberateness around a way of being in the world, which I think has always been cultivated among artists on the one hand, and often a kind of aristocratic upper caste, right? Which has fewer things to worry about. I mean, you need a lot of time to worry about the ordering of words in a sentence that you're sending to a lover.
Yes, exactly.
You know, like you need
the kind of tree branch that you affix to the poem and like have your messenger carry over to their house.
And the signal, the symbolic value of that. You know, I mean, people experience that today a little bit in the fretting over text messages that they might send, but I think not to the same degree, right? Like,
right. I mean, I think it provides an interesting example, I think, for the way we live today, because they were so intentional about these things and we kind of are interested in the same stuff, but to an overwhelming scale. Like, we don't send one poem a day. We send like a million text messages and consume so much other stuff. So I think it's almost like a pared down laziness or something. I think minimalism, commercialized minimalism, now offers the path of least resistance. Like, it's this smooth, frictionless, easy space. But really, it shouldn't be. It was meant to be a challenge.
Yeah.
and a challenge to like live differently. And I mean, what was so good about Judd's early sculptures was this process of like defamiliarization, where the thing did not meet your expectations of what is beautiful or what is an art object. And so to now turn minimalism into something that is mostly familiar and mostly recognizable is also like ironically against the original point.
Where do you see that movement going?
And I think the arc of Marie Kondo is really demonstrative here, where she kind of hit peak saturation. She's everywhere. Everyone knows who she is. Like, that's kind of amazing. And then tried to monetize her ideas even more by selling crystals and, you know, little home goods. I think I also talked to one woman who identified as a minimalist for a long time and used it as a tool to like get out of debt and figure her life out. And now she rejects the minimalist label because like it's too popular and it's too meaningless. And so she's so minimalist essentially that she can't even call herself a minimalist anymore. And so I think there will be this process of like, now everyone recognizes this. Now it's a kind of mainstream idea, so we don't need the label quite as much. And you'll just see a lot of people still trying to monetize it in the path of Marie Kondo and offering these like home cleaning services, or still trying to sell that like one minimalist object until like all trends, it will pass as a design fad and as an aesthetic, and we'll move on into something else. But I think there's a kind of permanence to minimalism, or it seems to be permanent because of digital culture now and this like overwhelming load of imagery that we see on our phones all the time. So why are we ever going to want like a super elaborate interior space if we're just staring at our phones? I'm not sure.
You know, in your own grappling with the question of meaning making in a life, have there been any conclusions for you?
Well, I think this living intentionally and like living according to your own tastes and desires and sensibilities, I think is my biggest takeaway from the book and from the process of writing the book. And I think another thing that like I came out of it with and experienced while writing is just how unaware we usually are of our surroundings and how like frictionlessly we do move through the world. Like, I think looking so much at this art and these artists and writers and composers, it made me like rethink my own judgment of what I see and hear. And so rather than just like letting things flood in and not thinking about them, I would kind of rethink what I heard. I mean, it's minimalism is very hard to describe. So it's like, what is good minimalism? What is good minimalism? Like, I think it's seeing your own sights and feeling your own perceptions. And like, I can't tell you what that looks like, but you know, you listen to enough John Cage for a while and you can hear the sound of a truck or the grind of subway wheels as like an interesting auditory experience. And I think that's really powerful. And I think there's overlaps with this idea of mindfulness that many people have pointed out, and mindfulness in terms of like being mindful of what is there rather than using mindfulness as a tool to like isolate yourself and kind of barricade yourself further.
Yeah. Well, Kyle, thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Dialogues is produced by David Zwirner. You can find out more about the artists on this series by going to davidzwirner.com/dialogues. And if you liked what you heard, please rate and review us on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen. It really does help other people discover the show. I'm Lucas Werner. Thanks so much for listening, and I hope you join us again next time.